Friends, today we are here to talk to an amazing personality, amazing person who has been a finest classical dancer, and he has been motivation, he has been an inspiration to thousands of people across the United States and all over the world towards the dance. He, in 1976, he started National Dance Institute, encouraging a lot of people, a lot of kids to learn dance. And let me introduce you today, Jacques Demwash. Did I say that name correct, Jacques?
Yeah, that is a Dam. It's a softer A.
Okay.
D-A-N, Dam Boaz.
Jacques Demwash.
Yes.
See, I'm learning today something new. thank you so much, Jacques, for joining us today. And it's a pleasure, it's an honor to meet you. So we would like to know a little bit about you, how you have encouraged so many people. I will tell you from my side, myself, Arvind Mahajan, we are doing this concert for benefit of NC Arts in Action in Raleigh area. But we know you are the founder, so our audience would like to know more about you as well as NC Arts in Action in Raleigh from you.
Well, first of all, Arts in Action is a name for a company here. It's an affiliate of National Dance Institute, which has about, 11 in the United States. Minds in Motion is one, National Dance Institute of New Mexico is another, California Dance Institute. And but basically they're all motivated by the same motive, is that the arts should be part of every person's life, knowledge. And the arts are an invention by our species to express emotion, whether it's in painting or poetry or music or dance or architecture, right? It's, and I was personally a dancer, so I started this National Dance Institute, which is a highfalutin name. But the dream is that dance should be part of everyone's learning. And I use the word learning because the word education, like how many times people would say to each other, oh, when did you finish your education? Oh, well, I have a college degree, or I got through high school. But if you substitute the word learning instead of education and said, when did you finish your learning? They'd say, what do you mean? I'm always learning. So this education sounds like it's injected into you and then you stop it, right? And so I don't like the word. But anyway, but it much better that the idea is that dance is important, that everybody know. It's just one form of the arts. The arts are very important. And I started dancing myself because I lived in New York City in an area that had gangs, used to fight gangs, right?
Mm-hmm.
The African Americans would fight the white, and the Spanish would fight the, they had these gangs, mm-hmm. right? And my mother wanted her children, she never finished elementary school, but she used to read about the French court and the minuet and the dances and culture. She used to read, and she thought that her children would have dance and music, and in particular, and the arts in their growing up. So she managed to find teachers somehow. the best. How this little, she was 4'9" in height.
Wow.
And she could take all of us out into the forest. She knew every plant and keep us alive. But this little grass, she'd say, oh, you can eat this. And this, if you press it and squeeze it, it tastes like lemon. And this, and she knew all these things. And a witch. She was magical. But anyway, so she found the best people and somehow managed to persuade them to teach there were four of us in her. My sister, I was the youngest, my sister next to me. When she started doing this, my older brothers were one was already going into the college, and he went in the army first. And so, but my sister and I, we had acting lessons with a man called Komissarzewski, who was a Russian from the Moscow Art Theater. And we had acting lessons from him. We had music lessons from Pietro Jan, who was an Italian. He was the chief organist in St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York and in Rome earlier, right? We had dance lessons with Balanchine at the School of American Ballet, which is the best there was. And she managed this. I don't know how she ferreted it out, just going and finding the best teachers and persuading them to take us, right? And the lessons at the ballet were free. And Pietro Jan taught, she persuaded him to take the children. And he said, my fee is so on. So she said, oh, so much? Being like it. I will bring you your big fee, right? For my daughter to have piano. Ninette, her name was Ninette. And then he said, well, I don't take children, right? And, oh, but you must, my children are much better than other children. You will see. So he said, I'll try one lesson, right? And then she said, all right. So my sister came, sat at the piano, put it like this. And then she came and said, he said, or I'll take her once a week, beginner's piano. My mother was a wonderful seamstress. She made clothes and she made hats. Women wore hats all the time. And she sold them on the street. She had a little stand and would sell people hats. And she cleaned people's toilets and she, right? And at the end of, she came with my sister for the first piano lesson. And she said, here is your big fee, right? $20 in dimes and nickels. She put it on the piano like this. And he, Pietro Jan, he took it and he says, Madame. Now, when she put all this thing in, she was a marvelous cook and she had made a pate, you know, like a pate, and a sauce to go with the pate, and she had gone. So Pietro Jan took all the coins and gave it back and said, Madame, your children can have lessons free.
Wow.
However, keep me in pâté. So she would make, right, each lesson she would make stuffed cabbage and different, she'd bring different dishes. And so now, after a lesson, always she brought me. So my sister would be there and I'd sit. And then one day she said, do you mind if Jacques sits on the piano bench with, so that he can learn by copying?
Mm-hmm.
So I started lessons. She managed two children getting lessons for stuffed cabbage. And anyway, so we had piano lessons. I had it for about 3 years, and then I continued it later into my teens, and ballet was free, and I started performing very young in children's role. And then the acting lessons, I kept them going into my teens too, and then eventually did movies and as an actor, but excelled in ballet. So that's how ballet
came in.
And then I quit school and joined the ballet, and right? And but I also, I guess, I don't really know, it's crazy, but in education, I was the dean of the State University of New York, full professor, 11 honorary doctorates, visiting professor in Santa Barbara for 11 years,
on,
right? And doing, and because learning is so important, and in particular reading. I think we can read someone and make friends with someone who, Marcus Aurelius, who was in Roman emperor, who wrote his memoirs.
Right.
You can read the memoirs and become a friend, right? With someone that's been dead for 3,000 years, right? The reading and also writing. How do you tell a story by writing? The art of writing, and it's the art of storytelling.
Right.
Once upon a time, there was a man. He had grown up loving literature and reading. He became a journalist, and from there he became a man that printed and wrote books. And so that's the introduction, right? He read so much that he had bad eyes from reading. So he had to wear these glasses. Now you start describing him, right? And because he didn't exercise much, because he was reading all the time, he had a little tummy. And, right, you begin to describe. And so how do you tell stories? And so I write stories, and I have written, I have a new book right now that's coming out, maybe in a year.
Okay.
It's a thriller.
Where?
Murder and violence backstage at the ballet.
Wow.
And it's called Pas de Cat, Pas de Death.
Wow.
A Pas de Death, like Pas de Deux, Pas de Trois, like a dance, a Pas de Death. That'll be out in about a year. And yeah, anyway, I like to write, and I keep a diary. I started a diary in 1962. I'll write about us tonight and coming here, and I write every night in my diary, and it's I recommend everybody keep a diary. It's at first it's just went here, spent this, met so and so, right? But after a while it becomes about ideas and what you're thinking and feelings, and it begins to get rich.
Right.
So, keep a diary.
So we got the motivation today. Keep the diary.
Keep a diary.
So
write and read.
So now, after all these experiences, you said you have been a professor, you have been dean. So how this National Institute of Dance came along in 1976?
Well, it's I realized that how I had been personally transformed by being engaged in the arts. But if you want to learn something, the best way is to do it. If you read a book on carpentry, how to be a carpenter, it's not as enough as trying to make a chair.
Mm-hmm.
And right, you have to do. And I just thought I was transformed by doing the arts. So I felt that dance and music, but my field is dance, should be part of everything. So I went to my children's school, where my children were going to, and I asked the principal of the school, would they like free lessons, right? And ideally it would be part of the school's
curriculum.
Yeah, or an after-school program,
mm-hmm.
But everybody, no audition, the whole class, everybody can take it. So that started, I started teaching it myself, but I don't want to teach without music, so I would hire musicians to come to work with me, to play the piano or whatever. If there wasn't a piano, I'd have a drummer, right? Or a flute.
Mm-hmm.
And, always live music, always. And, which asked the question, which came first, music or dance?
Yes.
Well, where did it first come from? I mean, mm-hmm. First time. Huh?
I said movement.
Yes, because you can't clap without moving. I mean, you can't sing without moving, right? Movement. So which asked the question, which scientists don't like, but they agree with. The Big Bang that they claim started everything there is in the universe is misnamed. How can you have a sound without movement? It was the big move that caused this thing called a sound that made the universe.
Right.
And you say this to physicists and cosmologists, and they agree, but they don't want to accept it because they've grown up with this term, the Big Bang. It's the big move. And when you realize that everything there is in our universe, everything in our universe started in a trillionth of a second, not just 1 second, one, but smaller. Everything, dark matter, everything. What an incredible thing. Now the other fascinating thing, this explosion of everything. Our universe is slowing down. Did you know that? The particles that are moving are slowing down. And maybe so many years from now, they'll stop expanding and they'll start reversing. And another half a billion years, they'll be back again to a single place, mm-hmm. which will explode. The universe is breathing. 10 billion years. 10 billion years. 10 billion years. It's fantastic to think of everything there is as some kind of expanding, contracting force. And if all those stars that we think are stars are galaxies, and ridiculous not to think that there isn't other planets of different sizes and shapes going around those stars, those suns, and life in them. I would imagine if whenever we get, we're already on Mars, they find frozen water, they think there may have been at one time some life form similar. I'm sure the rings of Saturn are full of life forms living in, we know life can live in sulfur boiling. There must be life all over the universe, all over the universe. The amazing thing is our species are able to make these telescopes and these our tech. The stone axe as a tool has become telescopes and space stations and Mars rovers and right and this building and right. What an incredible thing is this thing, this tool that we have. And we're going to take this tool of biology and understanding DNA and we're going to change our species that in ways that frighten. But can you imagine? You know, a computer is nothing but a conglomeration of something there is and that something isn't. It's zero or one. It is, it isn't, right? That's right. The existence of this idea. What a wonderful concept of numbers. There is one. There is take away one, right? And that's your basis of computer, right? And, well, imagine computers right now that are so sophisticated and they have successfully made solve problems that computers do with the idea of on and off or DNA. They've taken DNA and had make a biological computer solving very simple thing. What about taking, which is going to happen, and maybe in our lifetime, or at least yours, they will implant them in the fetus, and it's biological. Mm-hmm. So a biological computer will be growing with the fetus as it develops hearing and seeing and thinking and right. So that you'll turn on your computer with a thought. And all languages will be available, all knowledge will be available, implanted in the brain of the fetus, growing, and right? It's that tool transforming our species into something incredible, right? Incredible. And I believe that this, I may not, won't happen in my lifetime, but it may in yours, definitely your children. That, and it'll be that if a computer is not implanted in the mama's fetus, it's like determining the child will be unable to function in a world where everybody can have instant access to computer with thought.
Sure. So all these things, you know, amazing thoughts.
Already you find it blocking, you think it can't be.
It's amazing thought process, you know, how you think and how you are putting all the universe together and in your conversation. So I imagine that you bring all that in the dance form to these little kids, so they can understand and their thought process would.
Yes, I do it quite often. I did one dance. I started it here. If you think of a vacuum, that which is nothing, and you throw in one little molecule, molecules going around in this big empty space, right? It doesn't know anything. It has no knowledge. And now you put another molecule in, and after a while, the first molecule bumps into the other, and bumps. And the other one says, I am me. Well, how did that concept come around? It didn't come into existence until one discovered this. For example, I hurt my elbow. The concept, unless you communicate, you don't even know you exist.
Absolutely.
The minute you communicate, when we shake hands, when we talk, right? We are communicating, we discover, I'm speaking to you, this gentleman who I just met. So happy to have met you, right? I wish I was here longer. We could go out and have a margarita together, and right? I mean, it's communication establishes existence, that you have a sense of I and you, right? And that's why the worst thing is when you put people away where they are in isolation. You know there was a period of time where that people tried, you got in a tank where the water was exactly the same temperature as your blood. You had a breathing thing, they close and you're there. No sound, no feeling. The people begin going crazy. They think, they lose sense of time. They're in 5 minutes and they think they've been there for days. And, right? So the worst thing you can do is to isolate people. Right? Solitary confinement. People go crazy, right? Right? You have to have communication. The most important thing is having communication with someone else, right? And that, of course, grows other cultures, one of the things that National Dance Institute did and does is to bring, to introduce the children where I teach and work with cultures of the globe. So we've always had international programs. We brought Balinese dancers over and Russians and, right, Eskimos. I did program up in the Arctic,
wow.
Right? I mean, it's so that you can and dance together. Right?
You just
dance together.
You mentioned you brought different forms of dance from India as well.
Yes, which is, I think, I have to remember to call my office. We did a program called Chakra, where we brought dancers from India to New York and sent our teachers and to go to India, and we started an exchange, and we did a program called Chakra, and it's in a DVD film,
mm-hmm.
and I want to make sure that we send that. I'll get it to you. I'll get it to Marlon, and he'll make sure. And after we meet, I'll call my office, and they'll send it to you. And that was terrific, That was the one of the best, that. And now my program, I don't run it anymore. Whenever you get a job, if you want to do a good job, you prepare your replacement. So that as it gets better, you can now say, you take over while I start another one. It grows. And so Marlon represents here. We have, as I said, I think 11 in the United States. And I don't run them. Other people do. But we have teacher training. How do you teach this? Do you know one of the most simplest thing, but the most important? When you teach a class, when I'm teaching a class, any class, you come in. First of all, you let the people know what you're going to be doing, what you expect from them, right? That's it, and what they should expect from you. Then they're reluctant to try, a lot of them. Some are not, they're right. And the most important person in the class is the one hiding in the back, shy, tries to not be seen. That is your most important person. The one that's having the most trouble is your most important. The weakest person is the strongest, ultimately, because your job is to make the environment to help that child end up leading the group. Right? And that's the purpose of, and in a crazy way, you find so many things in our religious thing. I mean, like you read the Bible, or any, really, you'll find it, that the great religious leader, the most important, is the lamb in the herd that has the bad leg, that's being left behind. Pick that lamb up and carry him, right? The weakest person, the most vulnerable, is the most important, needs the most attention. And that's one of our, we do it naturally. It's like this, what else is there? What other way is there to teach but that way? So it's a good program.
So the teachers who are teaching this program, are they coming from outside, or are they grown within the institute, or are they, what kind of qualification do these teachers have?
They have to be, you're not going to teach music without being able to play a musical instrument. You have to be a dancer to teach dance. It doesn't mean you have to be the best dancer, right? You just have to know by doing. We learn by doing, not by, right, watching other people do. You get up and do. You learn how to cook, not by a cookbook. That helps you, that guides you, that gives you suggestions. You may get up and learn how to boil an egg, or scramble an egg, right, or whatever. And so our whole, we get teachers, and some of them, we have to train teachers that the most important person is the weakest, because they like to pay attention to the little girl right up front brings the apple to the teacher. I mean, the goody-goody child. That's, you want to get the weak one up there with the goody-goody child, leading, right? And so that's what we do, and we bring teachers together to train them to be better teachers. And I think if you watch a National Dance Institute class, and you watch how the teacher works, in the schools that we go to, the principal says to the teachers, go down and watch a national dance. Watch the teacher at work to be a better teacher. We really, yeah. you know, yeah. you started, right? And you learn and you realize, and now you can see and you can teach other teachers to be better teachers. Right? Anyway.
So all these, you know, with the teachers, with all the students who have benefited from, like you said, when you went to your child's school and you told them that I will teach you for free. So basically, you met all the parents of these kids. Are they able to grasp the thought which you had when you were starting this? So you must have, you know, those kids, you must have thought they are grown-up kids now, they're grown-up people.
I take them in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
I remember once I was in the subway and there were no, it was crowded and I'm holding on and standing, and there's this one person staring at me. And people in the subway, they're aware of it, but you don't look at each other, you avoid. So suddenly I noticed that around me, I had room. Everybody was backing away from me because of this one person staring at me. And they thought, right? And then I look at the guy, and the guy says, I was a tomato. I had done a show where there was the fifth grade was, it was about cooking. And he was tamatza la parasal. It was, everybody was a vegetable in a meal. And he was tomatoes from Provence with garlic in there. And so I looked at him and he says, I was a tomato. I said, oh, you were at PS so-and-so, tamatza la parasal. Yeah, and he said, and then I went on to be a crab.
He moved up.
And then everybody around the place started, right? And then the station came and he left. Good luck, goodbye, and he went out. And then the people came over to me and said, you teach a dance class. I have a daughter that ran. By then it was 14th Street. And I said, sorry, I'm leaving. I got out. But that happens a lot to me. Because I've taught so many children.
Sure,
and
sure. Another question is, you know, you have such a great thought process while you're teaching these dances, and, you know, it the life skills which you're teaching them through this dance, you know, from the moment it starts and the way they move, they learn their dance, how to control their bodies. So have the students and the parents come to you and said that my kid has improved a lot as a human being also?
Well, I don't know if the parents said, I've had parents who were in the program come. They have their children they want to.
Mm-hmm.
And we've had we just a week or two ago had a program with the alumni in New York.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, once every year we let all our alumni, we kept as who we're in touch with,
mm-hmm.
to come, and they come. And there was about 115 alumni, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they kind of took over the room. And some, oh, Oya, how are you, Oya? What are you doing? And I'm a nurse, or I'm a this, or I'm a sergeant in the Air Force, or whatever, Army, the different careers they've gone to. And you know, at the end, the pianist started playing some music, and they all started dancing what they remembered as children, right? The Appalachian Clog Dance, the other side of the world, and right? And some had forgotten, or they, And one of the things that's interesting that happened to me too, you do a role, you dance it, years go by, 20, 30 years, and now you try to recreate the role that you did. Quite often, what was the right foot, you're doing the left. You mix up whether it was left or right. And I don't know if that hasn't happened. I don't know if that, you're too young. But I always get up there and I say, I think it was this. And no, wait a minute, it went to the left. Anyway, but the minute you hear the music, by the way, it immediately sparks the remembrance of the movement.
Mm-hmm.
It triggers that muscle memory. And,
yeah. So this movement, you know, from the move which you started has become a movement actually all over the United States, right? So it is in 11 different states, I believe.
13, I think. 13. I heard there's two more. Ohio has another one. And some of them are, a few of them are copycats. They saw a movie about it and they're starting their own company. But most of them are started by our teachers, that children that have grown up, had families and are starting their own.
So the day you were starting this institute, did you ever think that this will go to these 13 different states and
affecting 45? I always thought that dance should be the arts. Dance is only part of the arts. The arts should be part of the learning of every child. And it would be wonderful if everyone could sing,
mm-hmm.
could play a musical instrument, could dance, could make poetry, right? I write poetry all the time. I wrote one just last week.
Mm-hmm.
Very short, I'm gonna give it to you.
Sure, thank you.
I threw my love at your feet, hoping you would notice, pick it up, and tuck it into your heart.
Oh, that's amazing.
Nice.
Nice, beautiful, right? Beautiful.
And it's simple. The best poetry is simple, you know, and not although you get Homer, right, the poet Homer, Odysseus, and all that, they go for pages and pages, and epic stories, but the best poems, let me try. I'm trying to think of another poem. I don't know. Give me a second.
Sure, sure.
I said to her, "Do you want to dance?" "Yep," I said. "How old are you? 12? 10? Not? You must be about 9. "Yep." "Well, shall we, now this is a woman, right? "Would you like to dance with me?" "Yep." "Would you like to go to Venice with me?" "Yep." She said to me, "Would you kiss me?" How did I answer? Anyway, that's an example of a poem, right? I did that for Emily, my assistant, who's, every time I say to her something, she always says, "Yep." She doesn't say yes, she says, "Yep."
So you've written poetry, you've written books, you've danced, you have learned music, playing instruments. So you have touched a lot of things in different forms of art. Do you see, like, you know, whenever we talk to different people, common man, he would say, would you like to learn piano, or do you like to learn singing? So people would say, this is a God gift, you know, you cannot really learn. Is there a, you know, if your vocal cords could have been God gifted, you could learn, otherwise you can't. So what do you say, is it a God gift which you have from in all forms of art, or would you say it could be learned through your life?
I'm not quite sure I understand. I mean, music and dance and theater and art and reading and writing and breathing, I mean, good manners, drink, these are learned. They're cultural things are learned so that we can survive as a species and not fight and kill each other and grab everything. We share, right? And first of all, we share for our children. We want our children to have the best. But children are only yours. There's a neighbor that has children. You want their children to, and you want to be friends with your neighbor. And so communities forms and cultures forms and states and cities forms. And usually first by families, then by tribes, then by many tribes that become nations that become, right? And hopefully the dream, instead of conflict, there is friendship, and that's the United Nations was started, because we had these wars between countries, and right, for territory, for this, for, right? And how do we solve it? And one of the most wonderful things to read is the Charter for the United Nations. Like in our country, the Declaration of Independence, should read it. It's so fantastic, a documentary, right? And when they wrote Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin and our early people that started the United States, they didn't think they would live. They thought they'd all hang, because they were saying to England, which was the overlord, we're gonna be independent. We're gonna be our own country. We don't need to have a king, right? We can form our own world, our own government. And the United Nations is an incredible organization. It has made success in many ways, but not the big dream. Look with Syria, and right, there's wars going on and people killing each other, and still going on. And so I always return to Hafiz instead of no, don't, right? You're not important. Is how can I dance? Come dance with me, come dance with me. And if we want to have our children, grandchildren, and so on live in a world successfully, the UN and the message of the UN is the most important thing there is. We should all support it, give money, whatever we can to support it. And the message of Hafiz is the best.
So here we take that, right? Come dance with me is the key line. So to make peace with each other. So that's the key. So to that effect, you know, we are doing this, you know, taking the message of National Institute of Dance plus NC Arts in Action to our South Asian community through this concert which we are doing in July.
And what's the date? I hope I can come for it.
So right now, the tentative date is July 13th. You know, July 13th in Raleigh Memorial Auditorium. We would love to have
you. I'm
going to
look at wherever my book is. I have to look at it.
Sure.
If I can, I'll fly down and be here for it. The 13th of July.
Yes.
I just have to look if I can.
So it would be amazing to have you and talk to our community as well. So from your side, you know, because they're not aware of NC Arts in Action in National Township. That's the purpose for this concert, so that we can raise the awareness of all the thought process you have had in the last 40 years, you know, giving out to these kids and all these adults who have grown with all this thought process. So what message would you give through this conversation to the South Asian community, which they could take from here and come welcome and see what NC Arts in Action do with their kids at the stage on July 13th? What message would you have for the South Asian community?
I'll come down here and sit down and say, what do you need? And then I'd make up some message that helps those needs. I mean, right? How can anyone, knowing what dance is, what music is, this invention of our species, we are emotional. We are not, when someone says to their spouse or their lover or their friends or whatever, when they're, you're too emotional. You're not thinking logically, right? Calm down, get rid of those emotions so we can, not true. Everything is emotion. Everything is emotion. If you want to change someone's action, change the emotion that motivates them. For example, I'll make up a story. The father and mother have a daughter. The daughter grows up and is a teenager. Meanwhile, there are other children that come along beside the daughter. The daughter's the oldest. There are two or three other children. The daughter falls in love with a teenage boy at her school or something. The daughter brings the boy home to meet the parents. The father says, oh, he's sloppy, he's poor, he's got long hair, right? He's a hippie, right? I don't want him around. So the daughter is, but daddy, don't talk about it. It's over with. I don't want him around. I never want to see him. Then the daughter runs away with him. She's 15, 16, and she runs away from home. And the father is furious. And then he says to his other children, Mary Ann doesn't exist. She's gone forever. I don't want to hear her name. I've gone to her room and taken all it and thrown out her clothes and her car. She has nothing here, right? Her name is gone. She doesn't exist. Don't mention her name, right? So the children and the wife, I have no daughter. Now, the daughter has a baby and names it after George, her father, the little boy, and sends a letter to the mother, right? And a picture of George. The mother, who's not allowed to say the daughter's name to her father, right, leaves the letter out on the table. Father comes in and walks in, gets the mail, a bill, another bill. Oh, here's a letter. And here, what's this? And he reads it. Dear Mom, right? I've had a little boy. I'm naming it after Daddy George. Right? If you can get a chance, I'm at this address. Get together with me some. We'll sneak off together, have a coffee, and you can meet, right? Little baby George. Right? And he reads this. So that night, the father had anything new in the mail today? And then the mother, well, the next thing, the father is asking the mother, can you get in touch with the daughter and say, I'm sorry, all is please forgive me, all is forgiven. Can you bring George by? You impose another emotion stronger than, I don't want her name spoken again. You impose another emotion and it changes the atmosphere. And so that's how to persuade anyone in the actions, by finding an emotion that will overwhelm the negative with a positive.
So you just narrated the story of several movies of Indian movies.
Really?
Exactly.
Really? Well, see, the Indians, India is ahead of everybody. I always think when you go and that...
And you have visited India, right?
Oh, yes. Oh, my God. I haven't been recently, and I don't want to go. And I'll tell you why.
Mm-hmm.
The same with China. We have a big problem.
So first
China.
Tell me, why did you go? And then tell me, why do you not want to go?
I went because I had studied Indian dance.
Mm-hmm.
As when I was growing up, I had some met people. And there was a dancer in New York City Ballet. His name was Denny Lamont. And he got passionate about Indian dance. And he used to learn, and when we'd go in for a ballet class in the morning, you'd hear the bells ringing, and there he'd be alone practicing Indian dance. And so that's how I first began to know about it.
And you got to know about Kathakali and Bharatanatyam.
Yes,
and
the different kinds
of dance.
And then I went there,
mm-hmm.
and visited it. I got the... Actually, I think it was the Ford Foundation gave me funding to go over and find Indian dancers to come and teach Indian dance at our school.
Oh, wonderful.
And that was the Donna Jams from a school. They had a school in Malakai Sarabhai.
Okay.
And so we started a program back and forth. And it went for about 3 years or so, and we did a big program. We did a big program where we built an artist called Red Rooms,
mm-hmm.
built an Indian temple,
okay.
out of foam rubber, foam, like this, bigger than this apartment, half a city block,
wow.
right? And we did a program in the Brooklyn Academy of Music at the Majestic Theater, where we had this foam rubber theater, and we did a program called Chakra, there's a film, I'm gonna send it. I have to call my office and send it to you, Paul, and you get it. There was a film made of it. And we had dancers from Malakai Sarabhai, and then from Kerala,
mm-hmm.
we had dancers from Kerala, and men
mm-hmm.
dancers, and we did a terrific program called Nandan and Nadini, two children that are born, twins, a boy and a girl, with one umbilical cord,
mm-hmm.
right, and. Nandan and Nandini, and when they cut that, they each have a life of their own, from right, and the adventures of the two of them, and,
okay.
in learning, and it was terrific. Chakra was terrific, and you'll get it, cause
sure.
You'll see it.
We look forward to
right,
it. Yeah.
And so yeah, and we kept that program going back and forth. And then I stepped out of the program. And this global international program faded away. And it's not that Ellen doesn't want to do it. I guess it just, it got too expensive to do it. And a big mistake, I think. But we had children from Russia coming to dance, from, and we started programs. But it wasn't to, it was to seed programs in those other countries.
How long ago it was?
We did one, it was 20 years ago,
okay.
Roughly. I've been out of the program for about 20 years.
Okay.
I stay, I have an office and I advise, I occasionally make choreography.
Mm-hmm.
But basically I pass it on. And Ellen, who is terrific, is in the process now of passing it on to her replacement.
See, this was 20 years ago, but you would be surprised in the last 20 years, a lot of things have happened in the United States regarding those Indian dances. A lot of schools have developed, a lot of people have come in here itself. So they don't even have to go to India now. You know, they could get all those exchange programs within the United States.
Yes. We're beginning to be what we should always be, a global nation.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, United States is immigrants from all over coming to find a chance to be different or change themselves or stay the same, or right? It's a, that's what's so great. You should read what's on the Statue of Liberty. And I tell, think of it when I'm listening to Trump, right? We don't want any Muslims. We don't want it, right? I mean, they're evil people, and right? As he doesn't understand what Muslim is, right? And as, I don't know, in Indonesia alone, there are 300 million Muslims. I mean, just Indonesia. I mean, the ignorance of that he represents us just is shameful.
So on July 13, we will put all these behind us and make sure that all come together and we say that, come and dance with me.
Come dance with me. And then the other Hafiz, how can I be more loving? How can I be more kind?
So we'll put all these salvation
yes,
together. Maybe we can
absolutely.
Start another program together and do this for the benefit of all the kids in Triangle.
The people don't realize what dance is, right? It's a basic invention of our species to express what we are, emotion, right? I mean, it's all our dance is a control of how we move in a space and a time to express emotion. So you want to see a dance? Give me a hi. Now this is not, this is again an expression. Not enough.
Yes.
And pull away. Hi. Too much. Right? Too much. It's exact. The control of how we move in time and the space. This is no good. Hi. Hi. Too much. It's crazy, you say. This guy's crazy. Right? It's, this is an example. Now, this is another example, right? Bye for now. This is no good. Goodbye. No, the wrong gesture, right? This is anger and aggression, and right? And this is bye. And also see, no weapon, bare hand, which is the purpose of this. Right? It's all, right? I don't have a stone axe. Peace, right? And, so the use of how we move and the time we move is one of the major and most essential forms of communication. And I'll give you another example. If I speak to anyone, and I speak the way I just did now, with a finger, aggressive, and a tone of voice, you, and my head like this, it is impossible for me to make the sound you, that sound, and do this. It won't, I'm unable to say you and do this. Why?
Okay.
Why? You know why? Because two dogs are fighting, male dogs, over the female dog. One of them realizes I may lose, stops fighting, lies down, and puts the jugular vein available. I don't want to fight. I give up. Submissive. This is submissive. It's, I'm not fighting. Come on, let's be friends. Can't we love each other? Not, can't we love each other? No, it's not possible. Because we are making a physical symbol with our, showing our jugular vein that we don't want to fight. We don't want to fight. Hey, come on. Not, hey, come on. That's how essential it is to sit at a table and have a conversation on how we can get along and not be, how can we get along? It's not going to work.
That's
so the use of how we use our hands, our head, our voice, the music and dance are the primary, the control of how we move to express emotion. The control of the sounds that we make to express emotion are the two primary expressions, movements that we have invented to express our emotions, whether anger, yelling and fury, or softly singing to each other.
Sure. No, it's a great lesson today for me. We got great lessons. And to the audience, would you have any question for Jacques? Last final question before we end this. Would you guys have any question?
Jacques, what's next?
Next is to come down on the 13th to be here. That's what I'd like to do.
That's wonderful.
So I hope I keep breathing.
We are had a pleasure and honor to talk to you today, and we all look forward to seeing you on 13th of July. So by the way, the concert, the artist who is coming to perform that night is NC Arts and Action, a group of students, plus we will have legend singer from India. His name is Shan. He will be coming along with great singer Arpita Mukherjee, who is a reality TV show winner as well, from show called Fame Gurukul, and then a lot of audience, local audience from almost 4-5 hour radius who would be there to have fun together. So we all look forward to seeing you guys there along with Jacques and NC Arts in Action whole team, board, and we'll have fun together. But thank you so much, Jacques. It was
my
really
pleasure
to talk to you, and we will look forward to seeing everybody there. Thank you.